If you were to replace every single part of a human being with a robotic counterpart, would they still be human? If you replace their internal organs with machines to serve the same purpose, are they still human? In fact, how far can you go before you no longer have a human, just a robot vaguely shaped like one? This is, surprisingly, the guiding philosophy behind Dead Man's Chest. When we meet Bootstrap Bill, our first sea creature pirate man, we are confronted with the philosophical question I just mentioned. How human is Bootstrap Bill? He's human-like, sure, but he won't be, given some time. The film reminds us that each one of these sea creature pirate people will eventually become a part of the ship. While this is a very literal representation of this philosophical question, Davy Jones is a much more complex one. There is, for some reason, a theme in this movie. The strength of human emotion. Ignoring all the cannibals, impossible stunts, and whatever else happens in this movie, at the core is the theme of human emotion, specifically love. Love in this film is shown in two key ways. Davy Jones' romantic love for Calypso, and Bootstrap Bill's love for his son William. Let's focus on Davy Jones, as he is the reason I'm making this video.
I accept that.
Long ago, Davy Jones made a pact with the love of his life. He would carry souls to the underworld on his ship, and one day, she would return to him and they could be together for one full day. But she never returned, and Davy Jones became heartbroken. He decided to lash out, trapping sailors and offering them the choice to join his crew or be killed. It's also important to mention that Davy Jones is essentially immortal, literally cutting out his heart and storing it away. Over time, his once human form has changed and morphed into a monstrous amalgamation of sea creatures. So, what does this have to do with the philosophical thing? Well, ask yourself this. Is Davy Jones human? On the outside, no. While humanoid, every limb, every part of him has been transformed into another creature. Not only that, but he has no feelings left besides anger, pain, and wrath. He has literally removed his heart, a symbol for love and compassion, from his body, and locked it away in its chest, and hidden it. And all of this stuff about his lack of love, his cruelty and need for revenge, his hatred of compassion, is all personified in one and a half fantastic and villainous scenes. We're talking about the introduction scene for Davy Jones and a part of the Liar's Dice scene. In the introductory scene for Davy Jones, we open on some fantastic CGI work by the VFX team. I know that it's been said a lot before, but it is genuinely incredible how well this stuff holds up. This film is 15 years old. Anyways, we see his peg leg, his claw hand, his tentacles, and all these inhuman features, right before his face is shown, and Bill Nighy beautifully and sinisterly delivers this important line.
Do you feel this? Do you feel that dark abyss?
Here, Davy Jones is not taking a survey. He's being condescending, toying with this man. Jones doesn't fear death. He doesn't have to. He can't die. He locked away his heart. He's not fully human. But then he says this.
I can offer you an escape.
Not protection, or more than you could ever imagine, or
everything,
or something along the lines of that. But an escape. An escape from death, not really. But an escape from the fear of death? Well, Davy Jones would know that firsthand. Then he is so rudely interrupted by, oh god, okay, that guy's dead, he's done. Davy Jones doesn't care that he was interrupted or that he was spoken out against. What he cares about is this cross right here, this sign of devotion to something. This idea of devoting yourself to something is the antithesis of Jones. The idea of loving something so much that it triumphs your fear of death itself is the very idea that Jones threw away out of heartbreak and anger. So, he lashes out. How Jones responds to this is going to be key to understanding his character.
Life is cruel. Why should the afterlife be any different?
Here, Jones solidifies a key aspect of himself. He views life as unforgiving and cruel, and has decided to make sure everyone else feels the same way. But let's go back to this line in particular.
I can offer you an escape.
And how that connects to this line.
I offer you a choice. Join my crew and postpone judgment.
Instead of facing fear and loss and
that dark abyss,
lost sailors have another choice, to give in to their fear and join Jones and his crew, slowly losing their humanity for 100 years of service. Grateful to be alive, this sailor says,
I will, sir.
And the crew laughs. Why? Because they know it's the wrong choice. Instead of an instantaneous death, this sailor will be trapped here for 100 years, slowly losing their ability to care about anything, as they become more and more a part of the ship, and less a part of the crew. Now, let's look at the Liar's Dice scene. This scene can be hard to follow without knowing how the game itself works. I'll explain the characters' motivations and the rules of the game briefly here, but I do recommend that you go check out the video by Lord Ravenscraft for a much more in-depth analysis. Link in the description. Also some other things, go check them out. Essentially, each player here, which includes Bootstrap Bill, Davy Jones, and Will Turner, is going to roll 5 dice and try to guess how many of each number is on the table. If you watch the video I recommended, you'll know that just by entering the game, Bootstrap Bill has sacrificed himself to save his son from losing and serving an eternity on the ship. He bets a ridiculous number, throwing the game completely. Davy Jones is not mad here because he lost. He's mad here because his master plan was interrupted by the one thing Jones cannot stand. Love. So he turns Bill's love against him. He turns it into a weakness, making him carry out Will's punishment, because he wants Bill to suffer just as much as he has. He wants Bill to see love as a weakness, not a strength. That's the philosophy behind Davy Jones. But philosophy alone is not what makes these scenes so great. It's a combination of complexity and the filmmaking tactics that are required to make such an iconic villain. In our scene from earlier, we are witnessing, for the first time, not only one of the most underrated performances in history, but also some of the greatest visual effects work ever. The fact that Davy Jones' CGI still holds up incredibly well 15 years later is a technical marvel, but while I could focus on that, I'm instead going to focus on what a great villain scene should do. We need to see, in that moment, how incredibly screwed the characters are. The Dark Knight, we've got the bank robbing scene, the television scene, the interrogation scene, and plenty more. In Star Wars, the opening shot makes our villains look massive and intimidating purely through the visual storytelling. But in Dead Man's Chest, even after the audience has been introduced to skeleton pirates in the first movie, we're still on the edge of our seats at the sight of Davy Jones. This entire movie has been building up to this moment. We've got frequent mentions of the Flying Dutchman and Davy Jones, which are littered throughout many scenes. And not only that, but visually, we've been seeing creatures more monstrous and inhuman than the last. This scene opens on a shot of a peg leg. Why is this important? Because it shows us 3 things. 1, this person is important. 2, they've obviously been through a lot. And 3, they are literally less human. They are missing an entire limb, which has now been replaced with a barnacle-covered wooden leg. Note that we haven't even seen the full scope of Davy Jones. In none of these shots is he entirely in frame. If he was in frame, he would be less scary. If he was just there, we would have no time to build an image in our heads of how terrifying this guy must be. To execute this further, we have Hammerhead Sharkman right here, which is probably the creepiest one we've seen so far, and you're telling me that this guy is even worse? God, he must be freaky as all hell. Holy crap!
Do you feel dead?
Jesus Christ!
This opening line is so good. We've talked about it already, but now we're going to focus on why exactly it gives us goosebumps. Not just in Bill Nighy's perfect delivery, but the fact that we're explicitly told by the filmmaking to be scared of this man. And now he's essentially asking the audience if we fear death. We're scared of him, and he's asked us if we are scared of death. He's literally making himself out to be the Grim Reaper. And if that isn't villainous as all hell, well, I don't know what is. Another part of crafting a great villain is making them seem powerful. Very powerful. And in every shot, Davy Jones has all of the control. He controls the flow of everything in this scene, and whenever he loses it for even just a second, he gains it back instantaneously. Not only that, but Jones can kill with three words.
To the depths.
This not only displays his absolute lack of care for human life, but also his complete command over the lives of these sailors here. One false move, and they're done. This is why Captain Jack Sparrow is so scared of him. This is why Jack makes sure that Will says something very specific to Jones when they meet. We know Jack isn't the kind of person to do this. We know that he often just rules with things, making them up as he goes. Rarely would he ever plan anything down to what should be said. We know something is up, and that gives us a fantastic sense of how intimidated we should feel. In crafting a good villain, our audience needs to find the major threat. We need to know the motivations, the means, the power, and the reason for fear. Davy Jones personifies fear. His motivations make sense and are even somewhat relatable for many. We know what lengths he will go to in order to carry out his deeds, and we understand not just his powers, but also some of his weaknesses. All in just one and a half villainous scenes. Thanks for watching. This is the first time I've made a video like this, so I really do hope that you've enjoyed. If you did, you know what to do. And if you didn't, sorry. Thank you to Nando V Movies for the playlist, which is linked in the description for many other villainous scene analyses. And if you want to go see some of my own work, including my own villain, you can go check out Ivan, which is a 10-minute short film about a man who receives a mysterious package in the mail. Go check it out. I'm pretty proud of it. And let me know your thoughts in the comments. See you next time.